U.S. and Western officials say Vladimir Putin may move to formally declare war on Ukraine as soon as May 9th. CNN's Natasha Bertrand joins us live from Washington. Natasha, the Russian president is already at war, in fact, if not in name. What could he gain from this official declaration on this important symbolic day for Russian citizens?
Yeah, Christine. So May 9th is a very important day for Russia. It is known as Victory Day. It commemorates the day that the Russian forces defeated the Nazis. And U.S. officials, U.S. and Western officials have long believed that May 9th could be a day when the Russian president either announces some kind of major victory in Ukraine or a significant escalation. And they're honing in on one scenario, which is that he formally declares war on that day, which would then allow him to mobilize his reserve forces. The Russian forces in eastern Ukraine have been suffering a massive manpower shortage. So this would allow the president to essentially conscript more forces into the fight and mobilize the general population there in Russia. This is also, of course, a major day of propaganda, so that it could also galvanize public opinion for the war by actually formally declaring that they are launching a war against the Nazis in Ukraine. Of course, this is a lie that we've heard Russia say repeatedly, that they're fighting a special military operation against Nazism in Ukraine. So this could be a moment when Vladimir Putin kind of seizes on this and takes this opportunity to declare a formal war on Ukraine, kind of mobilize the reserve forces there that he needs in order to successfully fight this war in eastern Ukraine. Now, there are a number of other scenarios, including that he could annex certain territories in eastern Ukraine, including the Luhansk and Donetsk regions. But so far, what U.S. and Western officials are really watching for here is that formal declaration of war, which could be very significant, Christine.
All right, Natasha, thank you so much for setting that up for us. Let's bring in Vivian Salama, national security reporter for The Wall Street Journal. So nice to see you this morning. You know, this is a war. It's been a war since the moment Russia invaded. But what would it mean for Ukraine if Putin formally declares war?
For Ukrainians, it's not going to make that huge of a difference because of the fact that, in their opinion, not only have they been at war for the last almost 3 months, they've been at war for the last 8 years with Russia. And so they would tell you that it does not necessarily make that big of a difference as far as operations go. But as far as their campaign, their ongoing campaign, to rally countries around the world to continue pouring aid into the country, to continue to convince those countries that this is a sustained threat, it's going to be a protracted war, and Vladimir Putin is not backing down anytime soon. Obviously, that goes to really support that argument that they've been making all along. And so, obviously, President Putin, pretty relentless in his campaign. He's been honing in on certain areas in Eastern Europe, and the Ukrainians say that this war has only just begun. And so whatever rhetoric President Putin is going to be using on May 9th, it really does not change the dynamics of this war for them.
Yeah, Putin's words. It wasn't long ago that Putin was saying that, oh, no, we're just having exercises along the border, that the West was crazy for thinking there would be an invasion. And here we are, right? Let's talk about that big steel plant in Mariupol. It's been under constant bombardment. Despite the partial evacuation of civilians, the State Department says it's racing to get more people out. Listen to what spokesman Ned Price had to say about the conditions there.
We want to make sure that the limited humanitarian access we've seen in recent hours is not fleeting. Doing so would demonstrate that there may be a genuine humanitarian intent behind this evacuation, and not just another craven attempt on the part of the Kremlin to change the narrative, to achieve a PR victory.
What are you expecting here in terms of a partial ceasefire in the region in order to get more people out? I know some of the Russian officials have complained they think they're mercenaries or something, you know, hiding amongst civilians, and they've been loath to allow people to get out. What's happening?
You know, Ned Price was actually just answering my question there yesterday in the briefing, and I asked him really, and I've been pushing U.S. officials to tell us, you know, is this a real attempt by the Russians to show that civilians are not going to be casualties of the war? Of course, we know that they have been extremely, they've been targeted all over the country, and so that is not the case. But specifically with regard to the steel plant, whether or not they are going to attempt to save whatever civilians are trapped inside. U.S. officials are very skeptical, obviously. We saw about 100 who were freed allowed to escape in the past few days. But unfortunately, it's been tough going. And of course, access and a number of other logistical challenges are playing part too. The Russians seem to say that they are committed to trying to get civilians out and that they claim they are not targeting civilians. Of course, we've seen the exact opposite around the country. But the UN and other NGOs who have been working to try to pull off this very challenging evacuation are facing a slew of challenges because of the logistics, because of the fact that the Russians have not been amenable to allowing them through. All the while, U.S. officials are talking about operations that are ongoing in Eastern Europe, saying that Russia could annex parts of Eastern Europe by mid-May as part of the operation that Natasha was just talking about. And they're very concerned that this will come with a host of challenges, everything from kidnapping local officials and forced disappearances to forcing local populations to use the ruble instead of the Ukrainian currency and a sham referenda. And so many challenges right now all around that eastern part of Ukraine in this third month of the war.